Today we have gathered and we see that the cycles of life continue. We have been given the duty to live in balance and harmony with each other and all living things. So now we bring our minds together as one, as we give our greetings and thanks to each other as people. Now our minds are one. The Earth Mother. We are all thankful to our Mother the Earth, for she gives us all that we need for life. She supports our feet as we walk about upon her. It gives us joy that she continues to care for us as she has from the beginning of time. To our Mother we send greetings and thanks. Now our minds are one. The waters. We give thanks to all the waters of the world for quenching our thirst and providing us with strength. Water is life. We know its power in many forms: waterfalls and rain, mists and streams, rivers and oceans. With one mind we send greetings and thanks to the spirit of water. Now our minds are one. The fish. We turn our minds to all the fish life in the water. They were instructed to cleanse and purify the water. They also give themselves to us as food. We are grateful that we can still find pure water. So we turn now to the fish and send our greetings and thanks. Now our minds are one. The plants. Now we turn towards the vast fields of plant life. As far as the eye can see, the plants grow, working many wonders. They sustain many life forms. With our minds gathered together, we give thanks and look forward to seeing plant life for many generations to come. Now our minds are one. The food plants. With one mind, we turn to honor and thank all the food plants we harvest from the garden. Since the beginning of time, the grains, vegetables, beans, and berries have helped the people survive. Many other living things draw strength from them too. We gather all the plant foods together as one and send them a greeting and thanks. Now our minds are one. The medicine herbs. Now we turn to all the medicine herbs of the world. From the beginning, they were instructed to take away sickness. They are always waiting and ready to heal us. We are happy there are still among us those special few who remember how to use these plants for healing. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to the medicines and to the keepers of the medicines. Now our minds are one. The animals. We gather our minds together to send greetings and thanks to all the animal life in the world. They have many things to teach us as people. We see them near our homes and in the deep forests. We are glad they are still there, and we hope that it will always be so. Now our minds are one. The trees. We now turn our thoughts to the trees. The earth has many families of trees who have their own instructions and uses. Some provide us with shelter and shade, others with fruit, beauty, and other useful things. Many peoples of the world use a tree as a symbol of peace and strength. With one mind, we greet and thank the tree life. Now our minds are one. The birds. We put our minds together as one and thank all the birds who move and fly about over our heads. The Creator gave them beautiful songs. Each day they remind us to enjoy and appreciate life. The eagle was chosen to be their leader. To all the birds, from the smallest to the largest, we send our joyful greetings and thanks. Now our minds are one. Now we turn our thoughts to the Creator, or Great Spirit, and send greetings and thanks for the gifts of creation. Everything we need to live a good life is here on this Mother Earth. For all the love that is still around us, we gather our minds together as one and send our choicest words of greetings and thanks to the Creator. Now our minds are one. We have now arrived at the place where we end our words. Of all the things we have named, it was not our intention to leave anything out. If something was forgotten, we leave it to each individual to send some greetings and thanks in their own way. Now our minds are one.
Today he's in a very dire state, but he was in a worse state at one time, not twice or three times, but once, long time ago. Fire had overtaken this world. The people's passion and desires had become so strong that even the land itself was starting to burn. You could see smoke in the deepest of forests. You could see there was a something burning. And soon enough, this fire became very high, like a wall of fire. It started consuming everything. It consumed everything to the point where suddenly the mighty forest started to fall. And suddenly it consumed even the mountains and even the people and the animals. People like your brother, your sister, your mother, your uncle, your lover, your husband, your daughter. All of them perished in these flames. They say to us that the world turned into a sea of ash. Everything burned down. All you could see if you were a hawk, from the north to the east to the south to the west, was a sea of ashes. There was nothing living. Now, what happens is there's a world behind this world. There's a river underneath the river. And there were two beings, not unlike the wonderful being I've seen painted on this on this hill on the other side. They were bird beings. And I want you to remember one name in particular. His name was Ikanchu. His wings, I wouldn't be lying. Maybe a swallow would have to fly a few hours before they would reach the two tips of the wings. So great were his wings. These heavenly beings flew down because they had been brought up on this earth. They had come from a village down on this earth. They wanted to come and see what's happened. And they flew from the heavens, Ikansu and Kune. They flew like a sickled moon they were forming into the sky, and they flew down. And what happened? They came upon Coyote, the trickster, who said to them, "You're looking for your village, but look what the world has happened. Look what's happened around you." And they looked down, and all they saw in this world was a sea of ashes. Nothing else lived, nothing. Everything had been annihilated by the fire. But Coyote said to them, "When you are flying, look at your fingers. These bird beings, these supernatural beings, they had fingers on the tip of their wings." And they said to them, "When they point downwards, that's where your village once were." So Ikansu and Ikune started flying, and their wings, yes, they started pointing down, and they came down on this world of ash. And Ikansu was hungry, he wanted to eat something. And he looked into the world, and he saw there was only ash. And he said, "No, this can't be right." And he dug into the ashes, and he dug, And guess what? He found something. Something that we may find here tonight. He found a piece of coal. And he counted with one of those supernatural beings that he understood that he found the piece of coal of the last tree that had been down, that had been burnt down in this world. The last tree, the little coal he found. And when he looked at this piece of coal, he said he remembers from his village that they used to play drums. They used to make drums from trees. So he did something like this. He knocked onto the coal and it sounded something like this. It sounded like something like that. And he knocked on that coal. And he said, look, I'm standing in the ashes and the ends of the world where nothing is living. Where everything has been burnt to the ground. But you know what? I'm going to drum on the last piece of coal from the last tree of the world. I'm going to drum. And you see, if I'm drumming in the ashes of the world, I might as well sing. So he cantered. If you can picture him now, he stood drumming on the last piece of coal from the last tree. And he started singing. And if he started singing, he thought, look, I might as well start dancing too. So he cantered, was drumming and singing and dancing when the world had turned to ashes. And he danced and he sung and he sang and he danced for 9 days. And he fell asleep. And he was tired. And he passed out. But as the gray sky lit up again from a faraway distant sun, and the ashes, the beautiful sky house of the blue sky was turned into grey. He went to look for his coal again. And when he looked for his coal, he saw something. He saw a little green shoot and started to grow. Now, he realized that he had danced, and he had sung, and he had drummed for this shoot to grow. So he stopped drumming, and instead he let the coal do all the work, and suddenly he was dancing and singing around this piece of coal. And the tree grew, and it grew tall, and it grew really, really tall. And he dug again for more coal. He didn't find any coal, no. He found stone now. I don't know what happens, but things, strange things happen when we stand in the ends of the world where there's only ashes. You know, we dig under there. We look for anything. Anything that's hard. Anything that feels something. Even if it's just coal or stones. And he found the stones and he threw them at the tree. Maybe this seems anti-ecological, I don't know. But he threw them and the branches broke and the branches fell into the ashes. Those ashes, those branches grew more trees. And suddenly, the tree of life was coming back. And the forests were coming back. And soon enough, the animals were coming back. And soon enough, the mountains were coming back. In a small village in South America, of Native Americans, they remember Ikanchu when he drummed at the ends of the ashes. He remembered as he stood there in the ashes of the world and he started to sing and dance. And they go out every year and they remember the trees and how the trees jump and bring this world back to life. And they throw stones just like Ikanchu do. They throw stones to the fruit. And when the fruit land on the ground, the trees grow and they share the fruit. And they remember something that we must remember today. They remember that the grief and the praise go together. That some days, to bring this world back to life, we have to learn how to dance. We have to learn how to sing and drum again and share the fruits and plant the trees. This we must do.